Simon & Schuster Audio presents George and the Big Bang by Lucy and Stephen Hawking. Read by James Goode.
Where's the best place in the universe for a pig to live? Annie was typing onto the keyboard of Cosmos, the supercomputer. Cosmos will know, she declared. He must be able to find Freddy somewhere better than that grotty old farm. The farm where Freddy the pig now lived was actually perfectly nice. At least, all the other animals seemed happy there. Only Freddy, George's precious pig, was miserable.
I feel awful, said George sadly, as Cosmos, the world's greatest supercomputer, ran through his millions and billions of files to try and answer Annie's question about pigs. Freddy was so angry, he wouldn't even look at me.
He looked at me, said Annie hotly, glaring at the screen. I definitely saw him send me a message with his piggy eyes. It was, help, get me out of here.
The day trip to visit Freddy at the farm just outside Foxbridge, the university town where George and Annie lived, had not been a success. When Annie's mum Susan arrived to collect them at the end of the afternoon, she was surprised to see George red-faced and furious, and Annie on the verge of tears.
George, Annie, said Susan, whatever is the matter with the pair of you?
It's Freddy, burst out Annie, leaping into the back seat of the car. He hates it at the farm!
Freddy was George's pet pig. He had been a Christmas present from George's gran when he was a piglet. George's parents were eco-activists, which also meant they weren't very keen on presents. They didn't like the way all the discarded, broken and unwanted toys left over from Christmas built up into huge mounds of old plastic and metal floating across the seas, choking whales and strangling seagulls, or making mountains of ugly junk on the land. George's gran knew that if she gave George an ordinary present, his parents would give it straight back again, and everyone would get cross and upset. So if he was to keep his Christmas present, she realized she would have to think of something special, something that helped the planet rather than destroyed it. That's why, one cold Christmas Eve, George found a cardboard box on the doorstep. Inside it was a little pink piglet and a note from Gran saying, "Can you give this young pig a nice home?" George had been thrilled. He had a Christmas present his parents had to let him keep. And even better, he had his very own pig. The problem with little pink piglets, however, is that they get bigger. Bigger and bigger until they are enormous. Too large for the back garden of an ordinary terrace house with a narrow strip of land and scrubby vegetables growing between the two fences separating it from the neighbouring gardens. But George's parents had kind hearts, really, so Freddy, as George named the pig, had carried on living in his pigsty in the garden until he reached a gigantic size. He was now more like a baby elephant than a pig. George didn't care how large Freddy got. He was very fond of his pig and spent long hours in the garden chatting to him or just sitting in his huge shadow reading books about the wonders of the cosmos. But George's dad, Terence, had never really liked Freddy. Freddy was too big, too piggy, too pink, and he enjoyed dancing on Terence's carefully arranged vegetable plot, trampling his spinach and broccoli and munching thoughtlessly on his carrot tops. Last summer, before the twins were born, the whole family had been going away. Terence had been super quick to find Freddy a place at a nearby children's petting farm, promising George that when they all got back, the pig would be able to come home. Only this never happened. George and his parents returned from their adventures, and George's next-door neighbours, the scientist Eric, his wife Susan, and their daughter Annie, came back from living in the USA. Then George's mother had twin baby girls, Juno and Hera, who cried and gurgled and smiled, and then cried some more. And every time one of them stopped crying, there would be a beautiful half-second of silence. Then the other baby would start up, wailing until George thought his brain would explode and start leaking out of his ears. His mum and dad always looked stressed and tired, and George felt bad about asking them for anything at all. So once Annie came back from the USA, he started slipping through the hole in the back fence more and more often, until he was practically living with his friend, her crazy family, and the world's greatest supercomputer in the house next door. But it was worse for Freddy, because he never made it home at all. Once the baby girls were born, George's dad said they had enough on their hands without a socking great pig taking up most of the back garden. "Anyway," he told George rather pompously when he protested, "Freddy is a creature of planet Earth. He doesn't belong to you. He belongs to nature." But Freddy couldn't even stay in his small, friendly petting farm, which had to close at the beginning of this summer holiday. Freddy, along with the other animals there, had been moved to a bigger place, where there were unusual breeds of farm animal and lots of visitors, especially in the summer holidays. It was a bit like him and Annie moving up to secondary school, George thought to himself, going somewhere much bigger. It was a bit scary. "Nature," he snorted to himself, as he remembered his dad's comments now. Cosmos the computer was still chewing over the complicated question of the best location in the universe for a homeless pig. "I don't think Freddy knows he's a creature of planet Earth. He just wants to be with us," said George. "He looked so sad," said Annie. "I'm sure he was crying." On their trip to the farm earlier that day, George and Annie had come across Freddy lying flat on his stomach on the floor of his pig pen, trotters splayed out on either side, his eyes dull and his cheeks sunken. The other pigs were gambolling around, looking cheerful and fit. The pen was spacious and airy, the farm clean, and the people that worked there friendly. But even so, Freddy seemed lost in a piggy hell of his own. George felt incredibly guilty. The summer holidays had passed, and he hadn't done anything about getting Freddy home again. It was Annie who had suggested making the trip to the farm today, badgering her mum into driving them there and picking them up again afterwards. George and Annie had asked the workers what was wrong with Freddy. They'd looked worried too. The vet had come. Freddy wasn't ill, she'd said. He just seemed very unhappy, as though he was pining away. After all, he had grown up in George's quiet back garden and had then moved to a small farm with just a few children coming to pet him. In the new place, he was surrounded by noisy, unfamiliar animals and had lots of visitors every day. It was probably a big shock. Freddy had never lived with his fellow pigs before. He was totally unused to other animals. In fact, he considered himself more as a person than a pig. He didn't understand what he was doing on a farm where visitors hung over the edge of the pig pen to gawp at him. "Can't we take him home?" George had asked. The helpers looked a bit perplexed. There were lots of rules and regulations about moving animals around, and anyway, they felt that Freddy was simply too big now to live in an urban back garden. "He'll feel better soon," they reassured George. "Just you wait and see. Next time you come to visit, it'll be quite different."
"But he's been here for weeks already," protested George.
The helpers either didn't hear or chose to ignore him. Annie, however, had other ideas. As soon as they got back to her house, she started making plans.
"We can't bring Freddy back to yours," she said, switching on Cosmos, "because your dad will just take him straight back to the farm. And he can't live here with us."
Unfortunately, George knew this was true. He looked around Eric's study. Cosmos was perched on the desk on top of piles and piles of scientific papers, surrounded by wobbling towers of books, cups of half-drunk tea and scraps of paper with important equations scrawled on them. Annie's dad used the supercomputer to work on his theories about the origins of the universe. Finding a home for a pig was, it seemed, almost as difficult. When Annie and her family had first moved into this house, George's pig had made a dramatic entrance, charging through Eric's study, sending books flying into the air. Eric had been quite pleased, because in all the chaos, Freddy had actually helped him to find a book he'd been...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.